Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Dear brothers and sisters, I invite all of you to thank the Heavenly Father for all the blessings He has showered upon us as a parish community, and also each one of you individually. Despite our frailties, shortcomings, sinfulness, God continues to love us and has opened our hearts to acknowledge His beautiful love shown for all of us. By thanking, let us also humble ourselves to acknowledge our sinfulness, sins which we commit against God and against ourselves and against our neighbor, and ask God's forgiveness to prepare ourselves to celebrate this sacred mystery. I confess to Almighty God
and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and in you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Take your son Isaac, your only one, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah. There you shall offer him up as a holocaust on a height that I will point out to you. When they came to the place of which God had told him, Abraham built an altar there and arranged the wood on it. Then he reached out and took the knife to slaughter his son. But the Lord's messenger called to him from heaven, Abraham, Abraham. Here I am, he answered. Do not lay your hand on the boy, said the messenger. Do not do the least thing to him. I know now how devoted you are to God, since you did not withhold from me your own beloved son. As Abraham looked about, he spied a ram caught by its horns in the thicket. So he went and took the ram and offered it up as a holocaust in place of his son. Again, the Lord's messenger called to Abraham from heaven and said, I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you acted as you did in not withholding from me your beloved son, I will bless you abundantly and make your descendants as countless as the stars of the sky and the sands of the seashore. Your descendants shall take possession of the gates of their enemies, and in your descendants all the nations of the earth shall find blessing. All this because you obeyed my command. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Acquits us, who will condemn? Christ Jesus it is who died, or rather was raised, who also is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus took Peter, James, and John, and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no fuller on earth could bleach them. Then Elijah appeared to them along with Moses, and they were conversing with Jesus. And Peter said to Jesus in reply, "Rabbi, it is good that we are here. Let us make three tents, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He hardly knew what to say. They were so terrified. Then a cloud came, casting a shadow over them. From the cloud came a voice, "This is my beloved son. Listen to him." Suddenly, looking around, they no longer saw anyone but Jesus alone with them. As they were coming down from the mountain, he charged them not to relate what they had seen to anyone, except when the Son of Man had risen from the dead. So they kept the matter to themselves, questioning what rising from the dead meant. The Gospel of the Lord. Jesus' obedience to God the Father Jesus' salvific love for all of us. This is the story of liberation God designed for the humanity, for his children. When our first parents sinned, disobeyed God, and brought sin and its all evil consequences into the world, it was God's love that led him to take the initiative to liberate us from sin. All of us know God is the source of love. We have every reason to love him back. But especially during the season of Lent, as we are dwelling with the salvific plan of God, God's specific way of showing his love, that is his initiative to liberate us from sin, is a reason we are drawn to thank God, because he liberated us, or liberated all of us from sin. He took the initiative. He took the first step among ourselves. If a person sinned against the other, or do some harm for the other, our style of behavior is, I am innocent. He has to come and apologize for me. I am innocent. I am not going to do that. But in the case of God, God was the innocent party. But he says, never mind. I am taking the initiative to liberate people, my own children, from sin. That is God's love. Our first parents wanted to enjoy God's glory. You will be like God. The tempter approached our first parents and said, you will be like God. They disobeyed God, obeyed Satan. What was the consequence? Sin came into the world, and also its own evil consequences. Now Jesus comes. He obeys God. God the Father says, take upon yourself all the sins of people, all the sins of the world. Go through suffering, whatever they bring upon you, go through it. Even if they nail you on the cross and kill you, please accept. And Jesus said, yes, Father. Obedience. That is Jesus' obedience. True meaning of obedience is there. Not only say yes, but also say yes even to the very little things that God has planned to liberate humanity. So during this season of Lent, the Holy Mother Church invites all of us to focus more on God's love and Jesus' salvific love for all of us. Today's gospel reading is about Jesus' transfiguration. The three Gospels, Mark, Luke, Matthew, had an identical way of presenting Jesus' transfiguration. First, the evangelists say, Jesus announced his passion and death. First is that Jesus announcing Jesus' passion and death. The Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and on the third day be raised. So the words are not the same, the idea is the same. I have to suffer. I am going to be condemned. I am going to be killed. And after the third day, I am going to rise from the dead. Thereafter, second is, Jesus says, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily and follow. Soon after saying that I am going to be killed, Jesus says, if anyone wants to be a follower of mine, take up the cross and follow me. But to our surprise, not a single apostle left Jesus. They all remain with him. The third is the transfiguration. Three apostles were given the chance to experience Jesus' glory, Jesus' transfiguration. What we heard in the gospel just now. Dear brothers and sisters, this transfiguration was in some way an anticipation not only of Christ's glory, but also ours. Not only of Christ's glory, but we all know Jesus was with the Father at the creation. Nothing was created without him. That is how St. John's Gospel speaks about Jesus' presence at the creation. So he was enjoying God's divine glory. He emptied himself of that glory in obedience to the Father. Took the form of this suffering human body. He was, while ministering, he was humanly divine. At the transfiguration, the manifestation took place. The three apostles who saw Jesus' glory, they were lost for words. They did not know what to say. So it was so glorious. And that is the glory that Jesus was in possession before he became a human being. And that is the glory that Jesus was moving forward after the resurrection. So dear brothers and sisters, Jesus gave this experience to the apostles to show, even if you take the cross and follow me, that is not going to be a suffering religion. I am not inviting you to suffer. I am not inviting you to walk for this glory. Suffering is a road that we have to go through. To convince Jesus' glory today for us, to convince us that we are moving forward, we are moving towards God's glory. Our suffering is the price that we have to pay. Compared with Jesus' suffering, what are our sufferings? How can we say what our sufferings? What can we say about it? Compared with Jesus' sufferings, we must always do it. When we suffer, sometimes people think there is no point in living and they commit suicide. But simply look at Jesus on the cross. Think about these 14 stations. How much he suffered. But suffering was not an end in itself. It was directed towards glory. So, dear brothers and sisters, in order to bring that glory to us, Jesus became a human being. He was willing to be obedient to God, take upon himself all the sins of the people, and he suffered immense suffering, and he gave himself to God to liberate us from sin. And it is for that glory that we are also moving forward. The more we suffer with Jesus, that suffering is not going to be a stumbling block. Always our sufferings with Jesus is a stepping stone towards God's glory.
Yes.